first thing I need to do is to remove this section of fairing down there, and then we have to remove the front sprocket cover there, and in doing so there's 5 screws that you need to order. The reason this part needs to come off is because there's a screw right down in there, or a bolt should I say, and you can't get to it with that on, so that all needs to come off. And then obviously rear wheel out, I've got new bolts to go on the sprocket, cut the links off the old chain, get the old chain off, and the temptation for me is just to crack on and get it done, but I know if I start with the chain it's going to cause me a problem later, because I need to use the chain to hold the front sprocket still while I undo the big nut behind there. Okay, so to remove this bottom part of the fairing here, you have 3 screws there, smaller ones, sorry, larger ones there and there, and the clip that goes in there, which is that clip there. Got quite a lot of crap on it at the moment, but all you do is basically pull the pin out the centre and then that will fall out, and then when you push the pin in it splays those 3 feet apart and locks it into place. Okay, so now as you take the last of these bolts out down this side, basically the panel will hinge from the area here. There's a tag normally about there, I think there's one there, and I don't know, I can't remember if there's 2 or whether there's 3. You should see in a second. Now, whether or not you noticed it then or not, I don't know, but that fell off the bike nearly a month ago, and it's part of the camera mount on the tank, and it dropped down through the fairing. I thought it had fell off. So back to these tabs, we pull that up to that angle there and it literally just comes away. Easy as that. That now allows us access into there. So that there is the position of the awkward bolt to find. I'm just going to turn the light on it a bit better. Okay, now if you can see, if you look right up there, we should be able to pick her out. So we remove that one there. Just reposition my light slightly. That one, that one, that one, that one for the speed sensor, and that one there. That one will then release the cover so you can get to the front sprocket. Now as a little tip, everything that I take off or out of the bike, I always put down into a jar or a tin or something so that I don't lose the parts. And if it comes with a bracket like that one just holds the cables up here. I leave it on it so I know which one it goes on. Makes putting it back together a lot easier. It'll be the same when I take out the one for the speed sensor. Lips are not working today. You can see that these are all a different length coming out of here, and the one I'm losing count of how many I've done. This is for the speed sensor, and then we can just release that. There we go, that's the speed sensor out of the way. So just tuck it up there, So that's those 5 bolts out, and I forgot to say that one there comes out as well. That's quite a long one that holds the inside of the clutch reservoir in. Once that one's released, all this can come loose and then I can release it. Now this is loose with that one out, you can just pull it out of the way and it can sit over there out of the way. Now the tendency for a lot of people is to take the chain off first. Now that nut there is on quite tight, and there's a, if you can just see, there's tabs on the washers that lock it into place. There's one on this side as well. So you just knock those so that it's flat again. And then if you've got a, what we call a windy gun, you can put one of those on there and knock it off in a second. You can also see how shagged that sprocket is. Now, when I replace my chain and sprockets, I always use either Renthal or JT sprockets. That's just because I personally like them. And chains, I always use DID. But this time I have been persuaded to try a new chain. So we'll see how that one goes on. So there you can see the tabs are now bent back. It does tend to chew them up just a little bit, depending on what you use. You should ideally use a chisel and not a wood chisel. I just couldn't find mine. I'm still unpacking an awful lot of my gear, so I've used a screwdriver, an old screwdriver, I must admit, but it's tended to butcher it a little bit. But yeah, it's done the job. I may buy a new one, but I'll see what it's like once I've got the nut off. I may well be able just to tidy that up. And for those of you sharp-eyed ones that have noticed how dry the chain is, it's because I was just too damn lazy to lubricate it, knowing that I had a new one sitting on the bench ready to go on. And after jet washing it and then riding it in the rain, should have given it a bit of a clean up, but was lazy. So next thing to do is to remove this nut here. Now when you go to undo that, you can see how easily that's turning just with one finger. Make sure I don't catch my pinky in that. So the second I go and try and put a socket on that and turn it, it's just going to turn. So what you do is you get a piece of wood and you wrap it around a towel, you jam it in the back wheel up against the swinging arm somewhere on mine. Need to have a look, see where I'm going to do it. I might be able to jam a piece through there up against the one of the main spokes, and then you don't go mental, but you just pull smoothly and firmly. That will undo, and then obviously the reverse of when you go to do it back up later. So there you can see the nuts off. I don't mind telling you, it was a bastard and a half to get that out of there. I've ended up using some of Lady Heat on it because it just would not come undone. So a little tip, bit of Lady Heat. Obviously down here a lot of bikes will have overflow pipes and breeder pipes for the fuel, so be careful before you apply Lady Heat in there, because she's not really prejudiced against who she will warm up, and if she warms up one of your breeder pipes, bang. So that's that bit done. Next thing to do now is down t'other end, and that is to undo the adjusters there so I can push the wheel forward. Well, after I've slackened it off, obviously, and I can remove the chain, stick the front sprocket on, and then take the chain right out of the way, take the back wheel out, change the sprocket to the chain. So the next thing we need to do now is to undo the adjusters here, and you slacken off the nut on the front, which I've just done with a 12mm spanner, and you wind it right back. And you'll have to do the same for both sides, and you keep going all the way back, and then once you've got that all the way back, you can wind the adjuster in. This allows you then to move the axle forward once you've released it. That will release the chain, and then you'll be able to take the back wheel out. In this instance, I'm going to actually cut the old link out of the chain anyway, But the wheel's got to come out, so slacken it all off and then use these markings here, lined up with there, making sure that both sides are the same when you put it back together, and then your wheel's in square. If you don't get it in square, it'll ride like a pig and probably spit you off.
Okay, so you see now that both the lock nuts are, or sorry, should I say the adjusters, are now fully slackened off. The next thing to do is to remove the split pin. I believe it's called different things in different parts of the world. Over here they're called a split pin because they're split. Somebody can't get his big fat pudgy hand in there and hold the camera at the same time.
So that's the pin out, and as you can see they get pretty buggered when you take them out. Some people will reuse them, straighten them out, put them back in. Frankly, it's not for me, for the sake of, I don't know what they are to buy singularly, probably 10 pence each, 20 pence, something like that. That's fit for the bin. Make sure that I discard it carefully so I don't end up with it in my tyre. Always replace it with a new one as far as I'm concerned.
Now with the pin removed, we can slacken this nut off, remove the axle. That will shunt the wheel forward, take the chain off, wheel out and move on.
Now I've loosened this with a longer bar, because these are torqued up to quite a high setting, and just a longer bar gives me more leverage, but once it's loosened off, just with an ordinary ratchet will do. Now the temptation is to put all these down. The thing to do is actually to line them up, and then once you've got the axle out, put them back on the axle in that order and you know where they've come from. So for the minute, mine are going to go in this top of my toolbox here. So now if I come back around this side, just a small tap on the wheel and you can see how slack that chain is now. And that will easily lift off of the sprocket. It would if I could do it with two hands. There we go. That's it, that's the chain off. As I said, I'm going to actually cut the link when I find it, but I just need to get the axle bolt out now, take the rear wheel out, and then I can swap that sprocket over. So there are the front sprockets, old and new. As you can see, this one's been slightly lightened by having those holes drilled in it. And the teeth, well, that's how they should look. And to be honest, that's pretty embarrassing. They are quite well hooked. I did hear tale of somebody that thought it would be okay to turn the sprocket over and run it in reverse and see if they could hook them back the other way, but to be honest, that's just taking the piss. For the price of a set of sprockets, it's just not worth putting your life in danger.
Okay, so you can see that I've just tried that sprocket for size. All this crap that's all in here needs to be cleaned out. But for tonight, I'm gonna call that half a job done. And then when I start again tomorrow, I can put something on the floor to catch all the crap. Take this back off, clean all the shite out of there that's built up. Most of it's just road grime and chain lube. And it's pretty crappy. Pretty crappy.
So there we have one broken chain that we just gently remove. And you'll notice it's back on the sprocket. That's simply because it was easier for me to put the chain breaking tool on it while it was on the sprocket. Just holds it still. And there we go, one knackered chain.
The teeth are worn on that sprocket. I mean, it's not totally dead. It might be worth keeping in case I break a tooth or something like that, just to get me out of trouble. But to be honest, it is borderline. And the front one's proper fucked anyway, so change the two.
So next is the brake caliper off. Once the brake caliper's off from there, you can remove the bolt from there, and the wheel should come out. So once you've got these bolts here out, you grab hold of the caliper and just give it a gentle rock from one side to the other. It drops off all nice and neatly, just as simple as that.
So that's the wheel out. Fairly easy to get out as you follow the procedures. I forgot to video the last bit of taking it out, so I do apologise. But there it is. Now I need to undo these bolts here and swap over the sprocket. And then I've got some nice blue bolts to go back on just to tart it up. These have obviously been loosened before I put it on the bench, just to stop it from spinning around all out of control. Now I can already foresee a problem. As you can see, the whiteness is coming through there. That's a little bit of corrosion on the alloy. So it may well be that the sprocket doesn't just want to fall off once these nuts are off. It might. That's actually quite a heavy old lump. Can go over there with the into knackered corner. Now I'm going to give all this a good clean up. There'll be a bit of wire brushing around here, and then a little tiny bit of copper slip on there just to stop any more of the corrosion, but it will be just a small amount. You can see I've only put a small amount of the copper slip on. That one doesn't look like there's much on this side, but there's a bit more around the other side. And as the nut goes on, obviously, it will spread that all around. Shiny, shiny time. So, the sprocket's in. These are only done up hand tight at the moment. And what we need to do is to make sure that's pushed on there squarely and firmly. And then you do each of them up a little bit at a time to bring it to pull down squarely. If you do this one up, for example, tightly, you could pull this side down, this side's going to be up, and then when you start pulling down on it, you're either going to risk cracking, bending or distorting, or it's just going to sit there at a slight angle and your chain's just going to keep coming off. So that needs to be 100% flat and into its fixings properly. These have got to be torqued up, but I don't know the torque setting off the top of my head, so I need to go and find that before I can do that, and then that'll be done. What I'll do is I'll go and find it, and then I'll come back when I edit it. I'll put on there the torque settings for you. So now some people will put these back in dry. I'll sometimes put them back in dry, but as you can see, I've got a little bit of corrosion on there. I've cleaned it up as best as possible. So just a little smear of grease. I mean, that is so thin, as you can see, it's see-through. And I'll actually take a bit more off before I put it in. So that'll be like that. It's literally just to stop any more corrosion, not really to act as any kind of lubricant. So there you can see the wheel's back in. It's only in there finger tight, but everything's as it should be. Next thing now is to put the brake caliper back on, so it all runs all nice and freely. I did clean out all the dust seals for the bearings while I had the wheel out. Re-greased the main side,
So that's all nice and tickety-boo. So the next thing now is to get the caliper back on, put the chain on, set the chain tension, and then torque that up. And rather than try and remember all the torque settings as I'm videoing, I will add them as I edit the video.
So we've cleaned all the crap out from in there now. As you can see, it's a damn sight less gunk in there. Can't tighten up that sprocket properly until the chain's on. So that's just on there finger tight again for the moment. Everything at the back's okay, so next is the chain. That's the front sprocket installed, all torqued up. I will put the torque settings on the screen for you. The only thing I've got left to do on there is to bend the tabs over, and then I can put the cover back on, and then put the bottom bit of the fairing back on, and then we're finished. Be able to go for a ride.
So the back wheel is back in, as you can see. The caliper's back on, and everything's all tickety-boo in there. Okay, chain tension is all set using these markings, and they've been checked with a ruler as well, just to make doubly sure, and obviously the same on the other side where the chain is. One vital thing, once you've taken the brakes off and you put them back on, just have a couple of pumps of the pedal to take out any slack that may be there between the pads and the disc. Otherwise, the first time you touch your brakes, they won't work.
So there we are, that's it, all finished. Sprocket covers back on, everything's torqued down. Again, all the torque settings will be at the various parts of the video. Bottom part of the fairing back on. More than those chain, those sprockets. All done.